So now we do swaps. People find this difficult. Level 2, it's scary to a lot of people, but it's not. I think why people struggle at level 2 is because they don't focus on the basics at level 1. If you get decent hang of this product now, it's going to be much more easier. At level 2 curriculum, if you would come and ask me which is that one topic that almost all the candidates find very challenging, that's swaps. At level 1, we have fairly basic stuff, nothing fancy here, but let's first build the concept around this. So what we know about swap is it's an OTC product. OTC is over the counter, and it's built for institutions, not retailers. So institutions as in the large investment banks, financial companies, they are going to get into this type of product. Like any other product, there would be three players in this market. There would be hedgers, there would be speculators, and then there would be arbitrageurs. These are the three big guys who are going to be operating in this space. And we would do example of each one of them so that you kind of conceptually understand what's really happening there. So let's first understand how a swap works. I'm doing an example of a simplistic representation. It's called easiest of the swap to understand, an interest rate swap. Going forward, I might just refer to this as IRS, an interest rate swap. There are two parties to this. The first party, later on I'm going to change this party. This party is a fixed rate pair. Going forward, I would simply call this party as a pair. But when I say pair, you automatically understand it is fixed rate pair. The counterparty is fixed rate receiver. So if I am paying fixed rate, the counterparty is going to receive fixed rate. Going forward, if I just say receiver, you understand it is fixed rate receiver. We always quote swap in the context of fixed rate. So I might say a pair swap. So you understand that I'm referring to a party which is paying fixed rate. If I say a receiver swap, a party which is receiving fixed rate. A swap will have a notional principle. Notional principle of, let us say, $100 million. It will have a fixed rate, let us say, of 8%. Okay. This goes in the agreement. That 8%, which is a fixed rate, that's called the price of the swap. So like other derivatives that we've seen forwards, futures, we've seen, now we're looking at swaps. What is the price of the swap? The rate that's written in the agreement. So 8% is written in the agreement. Why is this called notional principle? Because you are never really giving it or receiving it. It is just used for calculation purpose. Okay. So what happens is, for next 3 years, let's assume it's a 3 year swap. Next 3 years, every year, this party, a pair, is going to pay to the receiver 100 million into 8%. How much is that? 8 million. So every year, this party will pay to the other party 8 million. And every year, the other party will pay. So I'll have to use a little color code now. Let's make this guy yellow. So every year, this party will have to pay to the other party a floating rate. So it's an exchange of fixed rate with floating rate. One popular benchmark of floating rate that we have seen is LIBOR. Correct? So every year, this party will pay to the other party LIBOR plus, let us say, 1%. instead of saying 1%, I could have also said 100 bips. It's the same thing. So if I say LIBOR plus 100 bips, you understand it is LIBOR plus 1%. 100 bips is same as 1%. Now, this LIBOR is a number will keep on changing. Correct? So, this is the LIBOR schedule now. This is time 0, this is time 1, time 2, time 3. LIBOR here is 9%. LIBOR on this date, a 1 year LIBOR is 6%. A 1 year LIBOR is 11%. A 1 year LIBOR, they're not so volatile, but I'm just exaggerating the numbers here. This is 12%. The LIBOR keeps on changing. It's not a fixed number. Now, let's assume today is time 0. Do I know all these LIBORs? No. The only LIBOR that I know today is this. That's the uncertain part, right? But of course, after 1 year, I will know 6%. Then after that, at the beginning of second year, I will know 11%. Now, here is a trick that you want to appreciate. The interest rate that's applicable in this window for the first year, is it 9% or 6%? That's 9%, right? This is 9. And the interest rate that's applicable in this window is 6%. Is that color visible? This is 6%. And the interest rate that's applicable in, now I'm out of colors, in this window is 11%, right? So here is how we do the math. That in year 1, fixed rate payer will pay 8 million and in turn will receive, instead of this LIBOR, we insert 9%. So I will pay you 8 million, in return you pay me 10 million. Second year, instead of this LIBOR, we will insert 6%. Now here is where people have a lot of confusion. If I just ask you a second year payment, right? This is year 1. So let me also benchmark this. This is year 1, 2 and 3. This is year 1, 2, 3. If I ask you in second year, how much will receiver pay to the payer? So what you do is you would go to second year and you would say rate is 11. But that would be a mistake. You cannot use a second year rate. You will have to use a first year rate. You use one period earlier rate. So I'm also writing it. One period earlier. And are you understanding why? Because if you look at the second rate, second year rate, that's the rate applicable from second year to third year. We don't want that. We want the rate which is applicable from year 1 to year 2. Are we together on this? So now roughly this is at play here. Let's calculate the numbers. So 9 plus 1, 10. So this is 10 million. 6 plus 1, that is 7 million. And last rate is how much? 11. So 11 plus 1, which is 12 million. Now, conceptually, this is how a transaction works. Okay. But think of this now. So let me plot these two parties again in this, here in this corner. So these are the two parties. Let me also name them for ease of reference, X and Y. So this is X, this is Y. In year 1, X will pay to Y 8 million and receive 10 million. Does it make sense to pay 8 and receive 10? No, we can always net the cash flow. So then in year 1, you will receive 2 million. Are you following this? In year 2, I will pay 8, I will receive 7. That means I will just have to pay 1 million. So in year 2, the payment is going from X to Y. In year 3, I will pay 8, I will receive 12. So I will just receive 4 million. So these are the only cash flows that are really happening in this swap. That 100 million is not exchange. Doesn't make sense. I will give you 100, you give me 100. You don't need that, correct? So notional principal is not exchanged. It is just used for calculation purpose. What is really exchanged is the difference of those annual cash flow payments. Easy? These are the transactions on a swap. Why are they doing it? We will see that later on. Let's not worry about that too much right now. But how are they doing it? You should be comfortable with that. So these two parties came together, X and Y. They said, let's sign a swap agreement. X said, every year I'll pay you 8%. Y said, every year I will pay you LIBOR plus 1%. In year one, LIBOR turned out to be higher. Right? It turned out to be 9%. So then X benefited because he received more money in year one. But in year two, that LIBOR went down. So then Y benefited. So Y received 1 million. But in year three, again, the LIBOR went in direction of X, in favor of X. So X received 4 million. This process is called netting. And this is typically how a swap transaction works or an interest rate swap works. Do you want me to repeat this again? Have you understood this? Do you want to ask any questions? Okay. The question she asked, if it's a OTC product, is there a default risk? What should be the answer? Yes. Default risk is inherent in any of the OTC product. These days, yeah, how will you overcome? You can't. How will you overcome that? So when you sign the agreement, you do a basic credit checks. Correct? Credit checks as in who is the counterparty, will they be able to pay you? That's one. Second, not in your syllabus, but maybe you should hear this. There is something called as a central counterparty. After 2008 crisis, the dynamics in the markets have changed. So now what we have in the market is an institution called CCP, central counterparties. These central counterparties work similar to how an exchange clearinghouse works. That means even in these OTC products, now we have a margining system where both the parties will have to deposit some security margin. It's a complicated structure. You don't have to really get into that. But know that any OTC product, your default risk is never eliminated. It can be minimized using margining mechanism. Have I confused you? Did you understand? Okay, good. So you write this down. Think about it. Ask me questions. Alright, I'm taking questions. I have one here. Do we have any companies involved in swaps in India? I'm sure there are. All the big investment banks, they must be locking in the swaps. So, see, in India, we don't have a very strong OTC derivative market. But doesn't mean we don't have transactions. We do have transactions. But do I know of them? No. I definitely know hundreds of companies who book forwards. I worked with a few listed companies in risk management, and I worked on those forward contracts. And the most popular forward that I came across was a forward for exchange rates. So I did a project a couple of years back. It's a listed company here in Pune. We worked on the risk management, and they used to book like 2-3 forwards every month on foreign currency because they were involved in imports and exports. So we definitely have a lot of forwards. IRS, I'm sure there are, but I haven't seen any uses of them. Okay. Yes. In case of currency, some things will change. We'll do that as well. We'll do currency part. Let's think of a bank. A bank's balance sheet. Let's say that here we have liabilities and here we have assets. Now, what is the bank's liability? Is the deposits made by people like you and me. For the timing, we'll think of it this way. Okay. Let's assume there is a bank which has taken these deposits, and on these deposits, bank is paying interest of LIBOR plus 1%. That means bank is paying LIBOR plus 1% to people who have deposited money with them. That's possible? Yes, why not? So instead, think of these as bonds. Bonds issued by bank, LIBOR plus 1%. And then bank has assets. What kind of assets? The loan which is given by the banks to companies. Alright, so these are different companies to whom bank has given loan. And this loan is earning bank an interest rate of 9%. Now in banking world, there's a concept called asset liability management, ALM. What it basically means is, it's a risk management thing. It means that bank should match the characteristics of assets with characteristics of liability. Is there a mismatch here? Is there a mismatch on this bank's balance sheet? Yes, it's a huge mismatch. What is a mismatch? Let's assume LIBOR in a particular year turns out to be 3%. How much bank will receive on its assets? So bank will receive 9%. And how much will bank have to pay on its liability? 4%. Is bank making a lot of money? Yes, that's a good thing, right? But a LIBOR in a particular year turned out to be 15%. Now how much is bank going to receive? 9. But how much will bank have to pay? 16%. Will they lose a lot of money here? Yes. So banks are not supposed to do this. Bank is not a trading company. Bank is not a trading company. A bank is supposed to manage its assets and liabilities in such a way that there is no significant dramatic difference. If bank takes positions like these, then tomorrow when we go to withdraw our fixed deposit, they might not be able to pay. Correct? So we cannot afford banks taking such large value of risk. So the problem with this bank is that it will have to somehow also convert a fixed rate asset to a floating rate asset. Imagine if bank somehow, instead of having an asset of 9%, is able to convert that asset to a LIBOR plus 1%, or maybe let us say LIBOR plus 1.2, so that it makes some profit. Then is now bank safe? Yes, because its liability is floating, its assets are floating. How will bank convert? Imagine, what are bank's assets? Bank's assets are loan given to thousands of people. So the bank guy will call all of these guys and bank will ask, is it okay if I convert your fixed rate loan to a floating rate loan? What do you think it will happen? No, right? Because companies have already taken loans, they've already made their plans around it. So you cannot just call them one fine day and say that convert a fixed rate asset to a floating rate asset. So what should bank do now? How can a bank convert its fixed rate asset to a floating rate asset? What do you think bank should do now? Here is what that bank should do. That bank is Mr. X here. Let's put bank at this position. So let's call this as X bank now. So I'm copy pasting the same stuff here. It has a liability of LIBOR plus 1 and it is an asset of 9%. Now bank entered into the swap. So see what happens every year. Every year out of that 9% bank receives, bank pays out how much? 8%. And every year bank receives how much? LIBOR plus 1. See the beauty of this product now. Every year to your liability, how much you have to pay? Every year to your liability, come on guys, how much you have to pay? To bank, to its liability, liability of the bank, how much they have to pay? LIBOR plus 1. Every year on swap, how much will you receive? LIBOR plus 1. So you take it from swap, you give it to your liability. Are you safe? If LIBOR goes up, is that a problem? No. If LIBOR goes down, is that a problem? No. Because you don't care now, right? You don't care. Whatever is the LIBOR, you have to pay L plus 1. You are going to receive L plus 1. Are you safe now? Yes. Every year your assets will earn you how much? 9%. Out of that 8% you give on the swap. That 1% is your profit. What bank effectively did here, bank is an example of hedger in this transaction. Bank has been able to hedge its risk. And look at the beauty of this product, such a large book of the bank, $100 million. Just by entering into one simple transaction, they were able to manage their assets and liabilities effectively. Now they have asset liability management in place. Am I making this too complicated? Have you understood this? Okay, so you have to write this then. So then you have to write this, and then simply you can say, bank can assume position of Mr. X. Bank can assume position of X. Do you want me to explain this again? Have you understood this? All right. Let's look at a few more aging examples just to kind of consolidate what we're learning. Here is a bond investor. Now, he has purchased floating coupon bonds. Floating coupon bonds are also called as floaters. He's purchased floaters. So every year he receives 100 million, which is the face value of those bonds, into LIBOR plus 2%. Every year he receives LIBOR plus 2%. Here is what he thinks. So this guy is thinking that interest rates are going to go down. So if every year he receives LIBOR plus 2 and if interest rates go down, then will his income go down? Yes or no? Because imagine if LIBOR is 10%, how much coupon does he receive? 12%. But what if LIBOR becomes 5? Then how much does he receive? 7. LIBOR becomes 1. 3. So he's of the opinion that LIBOR is going to go down. He wants to protect himself. So what he wants to do is he wants to hedge. He wants to hedge. So there are multiple options. Option number one. Sell floaters. Whatever bonds you have, sell them. And buy fixed coupon bond. Agree? Whatever bonds he has, he can simply sell them in the market and he can buy fixed coupon bonds. But what are the disadvantages? Disadvantage here is, number one, transaction cost. Do you agree? You will have to sell once, you will have to buy once, so there is a significant transaction cost. Number two, especially if it's an illiquid market. A lot of bonds in US market are OTC products. Like bonds are bought and sold by large institution in big bulk. So it's not just easy to sell them. You'll have to locate a counterparty. You'll have to pay a finder's fee to your broker or dealer. Third, there might be a tax liability. Correct? The moment you sell, there would be profits. There could be profits, right? And then you'll have to pay taxes. So what is the alternative? What is a smart alternative? A smart alternative is he can enter into a receiver swap. See the beauty of this now. The moment he enters into a receiver swap, let's say for next 3 years, every year he will have to pay LIBOR plus 2. Every year he will pay LIBOR plus 2. Every year, he will receive, let's say, a fixed rate of 8%. Right? So how he is protected himself from the risk? He has a bond. How much coupon is he receiving right now? LIBOR plus 2. he will take that and give it on the swap to the counterparty. Whatever he receives on the bond, he will keep on giving it to other party. And every year he will receive on swap what? 8%. So effectively, he's converted his floating rate asset to a fixed rate asset just by entering into this transaction. By doing this transaction, he's being able to convert, he's converted a floater to a fixed coupon bond. Do you want me to explain this again? See, this guy has a bond. On this bond, every year he will receive LIBOR plus 2. This is the floater. Floater is a type of bond, a floating coupon bond. And then he entered into a swap. And on this swap, every year he will have to pay LIBOR plus 2. Correct? So whatever money he receives here, he will just transfer that money here. So he will receive on the bond, he will pay on the swap. And effectively, what is left for him is every year he'll receive a fixed rate. What is that rate? 8%. So that's how he's converted a floating rate asset to a fixed rate asset. Should I explain again? Have you understood this? Okay. Good for me. Write down that. Write this part as well. It's the same thing, yes. If you understood the last slide, you need not write this. But if you did not, then you should. Next example. I'm doing one more hedging example. Someone came to me with a Indigo stock tip yesterday. Who is that guy? Yes. What's your good name, sir?
Harshal.
Alright, so this is... That's the best I can do, Harshal. Yes, what is this? Who said that? Who said portfolio? I'm impressed. Spot on. Yes, it is a portfolio. It's a stock portfolio. And he's purchased all the dirt in his portfolio. So he's bought all risky penny stocks, distressed companies. And he purchased a stock. And now what he thinks that those stocks are going to fall for next 1 or 2 or 3 years. So he wants to hedge. Here is option one. Same story. Sell those stocks, all of them, and buy bonds. What are the disadvantages? Transaction cost. I'm bored of writing now. So transaction cost, then taxes. Then there could be illiquidity. Okay, so you know it. So transaction cost, taxes. What is a smart alternative? You know it now. Smart alternative is enter into an equity swap. Okay, so what is an equity swap? Every year he will pay. So let's say for next 3 years, this is year 1, 2, 3. These 3 years, he will pay return on this portfolio. And for next 3 years, he will receive fixed 8%. See the beauty now. Whatever returns he makes on the stocks, he will pay that to counterparty. So technically his exposure to stocks now is zero. And whatever, every year he will receive that 8% fixed. So his $100 million worth of equity portfolio, are you happy, Harshan? His $100 million worth of equity portfolio, just by entering into this small agreement, he's automatically converted that equity portfolio to a bond portfolio. He has zero exposure to equity now, because whatever happens on equity, that is borne by a counterparty. And every year he receives how much? 8%. Now the question you should have in mind is, what if there's a loss? What if there's a loss on equity portfolio? Then even that loss is borne by counterparty. So let me show you a situation. Let us say year one, equity portfolio, went up to his surprise by 15%. Year one equity portfolio went up by 15%. So he will have to pay 15 million. He will receive how much? He will receive 8 million. So net, just pay 7 million. That's how the transaction will work in year one. So think from his perspective now, Harshal's perspective. He doesn't care what happens to equity markets. 100 became 115. He does not get any benefit because 15 he has to pay to the other person. He just receives his 8 as if he's made a fixed deposit or as if he's bought a bond. Let's say second year, that equity portfolio went down by 12%. So now he will have to pay negative 12% and he will receive 8% net. He will receive 20 million or 20%. So think from his perspective. He had an asset worth 100. It went down by how much? 12. So his assets became how much? 88. Correct? But on swap, he is receiving how much? 20. Out of 20, he will take out 12. He will put that into equity portfolio again. So now equity portfolio is worth how much? He had equity portfolio worth 100. It fell down to 88. On swap, he received how much? 20. Out of this 20, he will take out 12 and he will put it in here. So how much is his equity portfolio worth? 100. And 8 is his income, as if he's bought a bond. So for him, his equity exposure is 0. Next year, his equity portfolio has gone up by 5%. So he will pay 5%. He will receive 8%. Net, he will receive 3 million. That's how an equity swap works. Whatever is the return on your equity portfolio, you pay to a counterparty. Now, of course, then what people ask is, what if he changes the portfolio? What if he does not manage it smartly? So the answer is that equity portfolio is fixed. Equity portfolio is fixed. 40% into Indigo, 30% into X stock, remaining 20% into another stock. He cannot alter the portfolio in theory. In practice, he can do whatever he wants to do with that portfolio, but those returns would be calculated based on that ideal portfolio. See, in practice, he can do, even if he can go and sell the portfolio, it doesn't matter. The return on the swap transaction would be calculated based on what is the part of the agreement. That's it. Is that okay? All right, then write down. And you can ask me questions once you're finished writing. All right, let's do it for the next slide. Do it fast. Fast. The question that he asks is, who is the counterparty?
Of course, the price is right.
So, the counterparty is, let us say, a person who thinks that value of stock portfolio will go up. Harshal thinks that value of stock will go down. The counterparty thinks that stock portfolio will go up. See, if you think of it, how come on the same portfolio two people have different opinion? That is the whole genesis of the markets. I mean, the reason why markets exist is because there are different people with different opinions. If everyone thinks it's going to go up, no one will ever sell. Everything everyone thinks is going to go down, no one will ever buy. There are always people who have different opinions. And who will find that person with different opinion? A dealer or an investment banker. Right? That's the job that you and I are going to do, that we would find a counterparty who has a different opinion, structure the transaction and then charge our spread. Are we okay? Ask questions. Have you understood this second year transaction? See, if there is a profit, you pay that profit. If there's a loss, you receive it. So when I say pay minus 12, it actually means you receive. So you receive that 12 and you receive that 8. So let me also be explicit about it. Pay profits, receive losses. Receive loss. Plus receive 8% every year. That's how the swap is working. Are we all right? Do you want to go more deeper? Let's do hedges now. Sorry, let's do speculators now. Now see the beauty of this product. What is this? This is a trading desk, at times called a prop trading desk of an investment bank. Prop is proprietary trading desk. Proprietary means your own money. So investment bank will trade on behalf of someone else's money, but they will also trade on behalf of their own money. So these are called prop shops. Prop shops. And in the US, it was like the most desired career for a CFA charter holder to work with one of the prop shops. You work and you basically are a hotshot trader. You book forwards, you book swaps, you book futures, options, you make money for your bank and then they will pay you. Lately, and sorry, I'm not very motivating, but lately what I've heard is that there is someone who's replacing all these traders. Watson. Have you heard of IBM Watson? You don't know IBM Watson? It's a robot. It's a machine. And these machines are replacing a lot of humans in the trade desk. And apparently, like what I heard this story of GS, Goldman Sachs, that they used to have a large proprietary trading desk with, I think, hundreds of traders. I'm not sure with the numbers. And now I think, this is what I heard. Now maybe it's a little exaggerated, but I've heard that there is just one trader left out of those 100. And even that trader is kept to do half of his time is spent on administrative task. He doesn't trade. The entire trading is done by machines, IBM Watson. But let's assume that it gets inverted, and it might, because a lot of trades are done by machines. We have seen some very crazy things happening in the market. For example, there is this some actress with name Hathaway, I guess. Yeah, very nice. You know that stuff well. Now, some movie was released recently. Yeah. So then on Twitter, that Hathaway was continuously coming. So these machines rate that Hathaway. They thought it had something to do with Berkshire Hathaway. So the stock price went up by 3%. Right? And that's the thing with machines, that there would be mistakes. There was a flash crash like few years back, about 6-7 years back, there was a dramatic crash in the market because of machines. Then recently, there was crash in the market because that US inflation number reached around that unemployment number reached around that benchmark 4-5, I forgot the exact number. So then what happens after some time is all the machines try to do the same thing. And because all the machines try to do the same thing with similar algorithm, it results into momentum markets. And momentum markets, the thing with momentum is when it's going up, all the machines are buying. It reaches to a level where it becomes a bubble and then it crashes. So we are living in exciting times. Maybe 100 years from now, you know, humans would have figured out that shit. Humans would have figured out that really, is that possible that, you know, machines will overtake entire 100% of the markets or not. But let's, for the timing, assume that it's the humans who are working here along with the computer. Now, here is what this guy thinks. This guy thinks that interest rates are going to go up dramatically. Okay, but right now he has no capital left with him. He has $0 to invest, no money to invest, but he still wants to profit from his opinion. Can he do that? Yes, that's the beauty of this product, swap. So what he does is he enters into a swap. What kind of swap? He says, every year I will pay 8%. Every year I will receive LIBOR plus 2%. Correct? For next 3 years. Now, if his opinion is right, and if, let's assume this is LIBOR graph, and if LIBOR goes up, if LIBOR goes up and if LIBOR becomes, let's assume 10, 11 and 12, every year I will pay 8, first year I will receive 12, then I will receive 13, then I will receive 14. Are you receiving more? Are you making profit? Did you invest a penny? No. So just by having an opinion on the market, by entering into a swap, he was able to structure this transaction. And how much money do you pay upfront? Zero. Right? Because at inception, value of swap, like value of forward, is zero. You don't pay anything. You just go and sign the agreement. End of the story. Your valuation is zero. But as interest rates start moving in your direction, your profitability starts increasing. Have you understood this? Okay. Take a photograph. Now this is a speculator. Huh? What if the interest rates fall down? Then he's in trouble. So, okay, the question that's being asked, what if the interest rates go down? How will he pay the money? Then he's in trouble. Right? Then that's where the risk management comes in. I can just keep on doing this the whole day. Like, we can have, I can create 100 different situations and show you how a trader can profit or a hedger can hedge. But hopefully you have decent idea now. Do you? Okay. Now a little bit of fancy stuff. Here's a trader. He wants to enter into a pair swap. What kind of a swap? Every year for next 3 years, he will pay 8%. Is that right? That's how a pair swap is. You pay fixed. Every year he will receive, let's say, LIBOR plus 1. So, he talks to this guy. Who is this? This guy is a dealer in this market. He says, please locate me a counterparty. He replies, he says, sorry, no counterparty. There is no counterparty available. So he says, fine, no problem. Now he talks to this guy. Who is this guy? Friend? Speculator? No. Babaji? So this is Babaji. Ek minute ruko. It'll be an insult if I don't draw him well. So this is Babaji. Who is Babaji? He's a financial engineer. He says, don't worry. We will create a synthetic swap for you. How? Enter into series of long off market FRA. Enter into series of long off market FRA with a rate of 8%. So here is our three FRAs. The first one, the second one. Now I'm seeing three. There is something which is a little technical, but I don't want to confuse you, so we'll go slowly. Each of the FRA will have a price of 8%. Trader got confused, but he is trusting Babaji. He says, fine. He locked in the agreement. Three FRAs. Let's assume first year, LIBOR became 9%. Had he entered the swap, you know what, for a minute, let's ignore that 1% here. Okay, just to keep things easy for us. So first year, LIBOR became 9%. Had he entered the swap, what would have been his profit? 1%. But he doesn't have a swap, he has a FRA. He has a right and obligation to borrow at 8%. Long FRA means borrow, right? So he has a right and obligation to borrow at 8%. Rate in the market is how much? 9%. What's his profit? Same. Next year, LIBOR became 6%. What's his loss in the swap? In swap, he has to pay 8, receive 6. What is his loss? 2%. Yes or no? He has to pay 2%. If LIBOR becomes 6% here, you have a right and obligation to borrow at 8. What is the rate in the market? 6. Are you borrowing expensive? What's your loss? 2%. If LIBOR becomes 12% here, what's your profit? 4%. If it becomes 12%, what's your profit? 4%. So by entering into this series of FRAs, the cash flow that he would otherwise receive on swap, he received easily on FRAs. This is a synthetic swap. Or this is how you replicate the cash flows of a swap by using a series of long FRAs. Are we okay with this? Take a photograph. I'm going to get a lot of opportunities to take your photograph. I hope you would go back home and write this. Again, coming back to the story. First, you went to swap dealer. He said no counterparty. Then you went to Babaji. He said enter into FRS. You said fine. Then you went to this guy. Who is this? This is FRA dealer. You told him, see, I need 3 FRS. He said, fine, no problem. I'll get them for you. First one for 1 year, then 2 year, then 3 year. He said the first one is priced at 7. Second one is 8. The third one is 9. These are the market rates. You said, no, sorry, not possible. I need all of them to be 8%. So since you are pricing them at not market rate, but at the rate that you need, therefore they are called off market. These are not the FRAs which are available at market price. These are available based on your requirement. And because these are at a different price, therefore they do not have a value of zero at inception. All FRAs, we know that inception their value is zero. But these FRAs do not have a value of zero. Their value is different. Are we all right with this? So you should take a photograph again. Just with that off word. These are not your usual FRAs. These are FRAs which are specifically customized for you. And therefore their value at inception is not going to be zero. In FRA. Okay, question she's asked that in swap you're paying 8, you're receiving LIBOR. In FRA, you're just borrowing at 8. How are you receiving LIBOR? So the answer is that in both swap as well as FRA, real borrowing or lending is not happening. It's a pure cash settlement. So in year 1, when LIBOR was 9, I pay 8, I receive 9. How much do I get? 1%. The same thing happens in FRA. I have a right to borrow at 8%. Rate in the market, 9%. Will I borrow? Yes. But I am not borrowing in reality. What is happening is there is just a simple cash settlement that's happening. I receive a net 1% of profit. So my cash flows in swap and cash flows in FRA are precisely same. Are we all right? Okay. So what you need for the exams? Pair swap. How will you replicate? You will replicate by entering into a series of long off-market FRAs. Receiver swap. You will replicate by entering a series of short off-market FRAs. Opposite of this. Now, do you have to memorize this? No. You can approach this conceptually. How will you approach this conceptually? Let's think of receiver swap. So this guy will receive fixed and pay. Help me with this. Receive fixed and pay floating. Play floating as in pay LIBOR. So will he benefit when the interest rate goes up or goes down? He benefits when interest rate goes down. Same story here. When you are short on FRA, how do you benefit? You benefit when interest rate goes down. So if you think of it this way, it's easier, then you don't have to memorize. So you have to build similar products. Yes or no? Take a photograph, do it fast. Or if you don't want, I'll skip. Okay, do it fast, super fast. You can ask me a question. Have you understood this? Same logic we can apply for pair swap. So pair swap has to pay fixed and he will receive floating. So what does he want? He want interest rate to go up. That's when he profit. Same story here. Long benefits when interest rate goes up. So instead of memorizing, if you think of it conceptually, it's easier. Are we okay with this? Yes? Okay. So back to this transaction. So financial engineer said, enter into series of long off-market FRS. Now, here is what you did. You called up this guy who's a dealer in FRA market. Dealer in FRA market said, sorry, no counterparty. So you wanted a swap, not available. Then you went to Babaji. Babaji said, enter into series of FRS. So you went to FRA dealer. He said, sorry, not available. You stuck. So you went to Babaji again. Said, Babaji, I have a problem. Babaji said, no problem. Or don't make things too difficult. Buy a floater. Sell a fixed coupon bond. Buy a floating coupon bond. Sell a fixed coupon bond with maturity of 3 years. See what happens now. You have purchased a floater. You're buying a bond, a simple bond. So every year, will you receive LIBOR? Yes or no? If you're buying a bond, you will receive LIBOR and you will receive that 1000, whatever is the face value at the end. Every year, you will have to pay as well because you're selling a fixed coupon bond. Selling means issuing. If you're the issuer, do you have to pay the coupon? So every year you'll have to pay how much? 8%. And then you'll have to pay this 1000. 1000 will set off each other. So again, it's a swap. So which means you can replicate a swap even by using a portfolio of bonds. There are two ways of replicating a swap. One with the help of FRS, one with the help of bonds. So when you want to replicate a swap, it's so simple. Every year I have to pay 8%. So I will issue a fixed coupon bond. Issuer has to pay coupon. So I will issue a fixed coupon bond. Every year I want to receive LIBOR. So I will buy a floating coupon bond. Are you following this? Should I repeat again? See, here is what we are trying to achieve. This is our swap. In this swap transaction, we are going to pay 8% every year. We are going to receive LIBOR every year. This is not available. So what we do is we go to bond market and we do two things. Number one, we issue a bond. Which bond? Which has a coupon rate equal to 8%. Issuing means selling a bond, receiving the money. Number two, whatever money we received, we will buy a bond. And this buy a bond has to have a coupon rate of LIBOR percent with maturity of 3 years. See what happens now. This is year 1, 2, 3. What do you have to pay? So every year you have to pay that 8% because you are issuer of the bond. And you also have to pay face value 1000. Every year you will receive LIBOR. Will you also receive face value 1000? So this will set off, right? Because once you're paying, once you're receiving. Correct? You're paying once, you're receiving once, the same amount. So net cash flow is zero. So every year you pay 888, every year you receive LIBOR, LIBOR, LIBOR. So you were able to replicate the swap simply by creating a portfolio of bonds. Issuing a bond is said to be a short position, and buying a bond is said to be a long position. Is it all right? So, now here is a larger picture. If you want a pair swap, you want to build a replicating portfolio. Replicating means a portfolio that copies the cash flow. You have two options. Option one, option two. Here is how we think. I am a pair. So you don't have to memorize anything if you think of this. Next 5 minutes, extremely important. Focus, please. I am a pair. I am paying fixed. What am I receiving? Floating. So do I want that floating rate to go up or do I want that floating rate to go down? Go up, right? So what FRA benefits when the rates go up? Long FRA. So here, I will take long FRAs. What type of FRAs? Off market. Okay, so that's assumed. So let me just put a star mark here. It's a receiver swap. So again, think. I receive fixed. What do I pay? Floating. So what do I want that floating rate to? Where do I want that floating rate to go? Up or down? Down. So which FRA benefits when the rates go down? Short FRA. So FRA part is over. Bond is even easier. I am a pair swap. Every year I am paying a fixed rate. So if I am paying a fixed rate, I will take short position on fixed coupon bond so that I pay that fixed rate. Every year I am receiving a floating rate. So then I will take a long position on floating coupon bond. That's it. This is done. Here in receiver swap, every year I am receiving fixed rate. So I will take long position on fixed coupon bond. Every year I have to pay floating. So short position on floating coupon bond. This is your learning outcome. This is what you need to know for the exams. At level 2 we do the maths behind this. Maths in the background. And that's where it becomes very fancy. But if you know this well, it's going to be much more easier next year. He said, when you went to FRA dealer, he said, no FRA. Can we create synthetic FRAs? Yes, we can. We can create synthetic FRAs. And that is actually option 2. Buying and selling bonds. Alright, so now your derivative level 1 curriculum is over.